Ladies and gentlemen, good day and welcome to the Escorts Limited Q1 FY22 conference call hosted by Anand Rathi Share and Stock Brokers. As a reminder, all participant lines will be in the listen-only mode, and there will be an opportunity for you to ask questions after the presentation concludes. Should you need assistance during the conference call, please signal an operator by pressing star then zero on your touch-tone phone. Please note that this conference is being recorded. I now hand the conference over to Mr. Vijay Sarathy from Anand Rathi Share and Stock Brokers. Thank you, and over to you, sir.
Thank you, Mallika. Good evening, and on behalf of Anand Rathi, I welcome you all for the Escorts Limited Q1 FY22 results earnings call. I also take this opportunity to welcome the management team from Escorts Limited. We have Mr. Bharat Madan, the Group CFO and Corporate Head, Shenu Agarwal, CEO, Escorts Agri-Machinery, Mr. Hemant, CEO, Escorts Construction Equipment, and the investor relations team at Escorts. As always, we would start the call with brief opening remarks from the management, followed by the Q&A session. Before we start, I would like to add that some of the statements that we make today will be forward-looking in nature and are subject to risks as outlined in the annual report and presentation. At this point, I would request Mr. Madan to make his opening remarks. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, Vijay. Good evening, everyone, and thank you all for joining us on this earnings call for the first quarter ended 30th June 2021. I trust each of you and your families are safe and well. At Escorts, safety and well-being of our customers, dealers, suppliers, and employees is of utmost importance. I'm pleased to inform you that our employees, including third-party role workforce, have been vaccinated against COVID for the first dose, and the vaccination drive for second dose is on. We continue to take all the safety precautions in all our business premises as per government guidelines. Few highlights of the company's standalone performance for Q1 ended June 2021 are as follows. Please do note that due to COVID-19 impact, the figures for the current as well as corresponding previous quarter do not represent normal level of operations, and to that extent are not strictly comparable, and growth figures may be skewed. Coming to the highlights, revenue from operations was up by 57.5% at 1,671.5 crore as against 1,061.6 crore in Q1 last year, previous fiscal, led by growth across all three divisions. Tractor sales volume up by 42.9% year-on-year to 25,935 tractors, our highest ever volume for this quarter. Construction equipment sales up by 159% year-on-year to 606 units. Railway equipment division sales up by 117.5% year-on-year to 119.4 crore. EBITDA at 233.2 crore is up by 95% as against 119.6 crore last year, quarter one. EBITDA margin for Q1 FY22 at 14% is up by 269 basis points as against 11.3% last year, same quarter. The company continues to be net debt-free with sufficient available liquidity for growth. PBT at 246.1 crore is up by 103.3% as against 121.1 crore last year, same quarter. Net profit more than doubled to 185.2 crore as against 92.2 crore last year, same quarter. On consolidated basis, financial performance for Q1 FY22 is as follows. Revenue from operations was up by 56.2% year-on-year at 1,701.8 crore. EBITDA at 236.4 crore is up by 94%. Net profit improved to 178.5 crore, is up by 92.8%. EPS at consolidated level stands at 18.13 as against 10.78 last year, same quarter. Now moving on to the segmental business performance, starting with the agri-machinery business. The domestic tractor industry volume for the quarter ended June 2021 went up by 38.9% to 229,000 tractors as compared to 165,000 tractors in same quarter previous fiscal. This is on the low base of last year, especially of April when the company was in the lockdown. Just May and June growth, excluding April, is at 8.3%. This is highest ever industry volume for April to June quarter. All macroeconomic factors remains positive. Monsoon after a 3-week hiatus has recovered well and sowing also has got pace. This coupled with all-time high rabi crop procurement by the government augurs well for the industry in the next few months. Most of the dealerships are now open and can fully serve customers. Our domestic tractor volume was at 24,500 tractors in quarter ended June 2021 as against 17,690 tractors in same quarter previous fiscal. This is a growth of 38.5%, which is almost in line with industry growth. Our dealer inventory level in terms of number of days of sale continues to be lower than the industry average. We continue to embark on our growth path by leveraging our two brands, FarmTrac and PowerTrac, through differentiated new products and through dual distribution strategy. Our total dealer count in India now stands at 1100 plus, with most of our new dealers coming up in southern and western regions. On back of new product launches, the penetration of our product has been increasing in more than 40 HP tractor segment. And during the last quarter also, 60% of our total sales came from above 40 HP segment. We are also now focusing on agri implements and attachment segment and have launched two major product lines here in the previous quarter. On export side, industry was up by 146.7% to 26,600 tractors as compared to 10,800 tractors in last year Q1. Our export volumes went up by 212% to 1,435 tractors as against 460 tractors in Q1 last year. This is driven by focus on product development and on appointing new channel partners. Sales through global also gradually increasing as we are ramping up our supplies to global. EBIT margins for agri machinery business went up by 112 basis points to 15.6% as against 14.5% last year Q1. Despite three price increases in the last 9 months, inflation and raw material prices is continuing to adversely impact our contribution margins. In quarter one of this fiscal, we have been able to partly neutralize this impact through cost savings and through higher volumes. Now coming to the construction equipment business, our served industry comprising backhoe loader, pick and carry cranes and compactors grew by 66% in Q1 FY22 over Q1 FY21. Crane industry grew by 214% but has shifted to price sensitive Hydra segment. Compactor industry grew by 110% and backhoe loaders grew by 44%. Our total volume comprising both manufactured and traded products grew by 159% to 606 machines as against 234 machines in the previous fiscal. Segment revenue went up by 168.3% at 140.8 crores as against 52.5 crores in corresponding quarter previous fiscal. EBIT margins at negative 2.3% for the quarter ended June 2021 as against negative 32% in the previous fiscal. The second wave was more widespread and severe as compared to the first wave. But the ecosystem was better prepared this time. Localized and selective lockdowns and related low labor migration resulted in better productivity on project sites. However, concerns related to likely subsequent waves, increased prices of equipment due to CEV4 emission norms implementation and commodity inflation and tighter financing control are expected to get neutralized over the next few quarters. We expect going forward with government thrust on asset monetization, Build India thrust to revive the economy and improve liquidity availability, demand is expected to recover to its full potential from October 21 onwards post the monsoon season. With road project execution target set at 40 kilometers per day against 37 kilometers per day achieved last year, construction equipment growth looks promising. Road construction being the largest driver for construction equipment demand. For full year FY22, we expect construction equipment segment to grow in mid-teens and margins for the segment to improve further, led by our various operating matrices and break-even point reduction measures that we have spoken about many times in the past. Coming to the railway division, revenue for the first quarter went up by 117.5% at 119.4 crores in quarter ended June 21 as against 54.9 crores in the corresponding quarter. Sales from new products more than doubled and now contribute 63% to total division sales as against 43% last year corresponding quarter. EBIT margin for quarter ended June 21 stood at 14.6% as against 2.6% in the previous year. Indian Railways still not running its full operations due to unprecedented COVID-19 pandemic and have cut down the annual production rate, affecting fresh order tendering and order inflow. Order book for the division at end of June 21 was more than 300 crores, and going forward with government safety measures and vaccination drive picking up at fast pace, we expect that tendering process will get back to pre-COVID levels within the current fiscal. For FY22, we expect railway equipment segment to grow by lower double digit, and margins for the segment are likely to be maintained around last year's level. So I request the moderator to open the floor for Q&A.
Thank you very much. We will now begin the question and answer session. Anyone who wishes to ask a question may press star and one on the touchtone telephone. If you wish to remove yourself from the question queue, you may press star and two. Participants are requested to use handsets while asking a question. Ladies and gentlemen, we will wait for a moment while the question queue assembles. The first question is from the line of Gunjan Prithyani from Bank of America. Please go ahead.
Yeah, hi. Thanks for taking my question. I had two questions. Firstly, if you can give us better color on the demand side. Clearly, Q1 initially, you know, we did see the lockdown impact. But in terms of on-the-ground fundamentals, what are you seeing? And also, if you can give some sense on the inventory situation in the market. I'll go to the second question after that.
Gunjan, is that for trackers?
Yes.
Okay, this is Shenu. So as Bharat has also explained in his opening remarks, the industry was roughly 39% up in quarter one. But we have to see it in the light of, you know, last year lockdowns, where April was very, very dull last year. And therefore, if we just look at May and June, the industry growth is roughly around 8%. Instead of 39, that appears for quarter one because of last year's slowdown in April. Right. So that is what I think is the real kind of industry growth we have witnessed so far, roughly between 6 to 8%. Since the July is already out, so we know May, June, July is roughly around 6% growth. Now, so the macroeconomic factors are quite okay, positive. We had a little bit of a worry in the middle of June, when the monsoon kind of slowed down and therefore affecting the sowing of the kharif crops. So there was a slowdown in monsoon for about 3 weeks. But fortunately enough, the monsoon recovered very, very well and in a very short period of time, right? And therefore today, I think we are pretty much okay on the rainfall. And also sowing has caught up pace by now. And even on sowing, I think we are good right now, right? So although there was a worry in a couple of weeks, 2-3 weeks, mid June to mid July, but now I think the sentiment is again positive, since monsoon is fine and the sowing is also fine right now. So on ground we see no challenges really right now. The prices are good, the production has been good, the procurement has been good of the last rabi crop. So the positive sentiment is, of course, positive.
So would you stick with the guidance, or is there any case to revisit the guidance for F22? I mean, positive growth of what magnitude? If you can talk about that.
Yeah, so right now I think we'll stick to the guidance. A lot has to be seen during the festive season. But as I said, the sentiment has become positive again. Now, so we are expecting a good festive season coming up, you know, which is like Navratras to Diwali period, Navratras to Diwali. Yeah, but overall, we'd like to stick to the estimate given before on the industry.
Okay, and second question is on the margin side. If it'll be great if you can help us understand that what kind of commodity hit that we saw from, you know, compared to last quarter. And the price increase is taken. From what I recollect, last call you all had shared that there was an under recovery of 3% odd. So, is, you know, have incrementally, what has been the movement on both commodity as well as the price? Sorry, again, this is on tractors.
So, Gunjan, as we mentioned last time also in the call, so that under recovery, like we have been passing on the price increases to the market with some lag. So the lag is roughly a quarter. So in the June quarter, we had passed on all the cost increases which happened till March quarter. And in the June quarter, inflation we have passed on in the month of July. We already taken one price increase, now it's been announced, which is the third price increase which we've done now in the last 9 months. So as of now, as we stand, at the end of June, the entire inflation till June has been passed on to the market. But yes, so there's further inflation which is coming up in the current quarter, which obviously we are not sure. It may be again another 2% which may happen. So that's something which probably will have to be seen. When do we pass it on, in Q3 or when later? So that's something which we're still observing. So definitely it's still not ended. So the inflation pressure continues, though it's not as severe as we saw in the last quarter. But the pressure is still on. So let's see how the industry reacts to that going forward.
So you, if I got it right, you incremental, there is still 2% pressure from the commodity side that we could see in this quarter, keeping the operating leverage aside.
That's right.
Okay. Just last thing, if I can ask, cumulatively, can you just give us the perspective of how much has been the commodity increase since, you know, September last year, or you know just last four quarters, how it's, you know, total increase versus total price increases taken by Escorts, just cumulative number if you can share.
Cumulative, I think on the material cost front, it's almost 10-12% cost increase which has seen already happened, and we have on the sale price it'll be close to or just 7-8% sort of increase which has happened. So we've been able to pass on that increase so far in the last three price increases till June. And like you said, 2% is still further, which may come up in this quarter. So that will be later. So cumulatively, it'd be almost 10% of your realization, which has come as a price increase this time because of inflation.
Okay, got it. I'll fall back in with you. Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Jinesh Gandhi from Motilal Oswal Financial Services. Please go ahead.
Hi, sir. My question first pertains to the outlook. So are we maintaining our guidance of about 5-6% growth for FY22?
Jinesh, this is Shenu. So yeah, as I said, you know, we are sticking to that guidance of low single-digit increase in the industry right now. As I explained, if we look at just May, June, and July, the industry growth has been roughly 6%. I think we should ignore April because of last year's low base in April, right? And sure. And we think from month on month it may change because last year there were many ups and downs because of supply chain situation. Yeah, but overall I think we'll maintain roughly around this kind of a guidance.
So if I go by that guidance, effectively it means that for the remaining 9 months or remaining 8 months, there would be no growth, in fact, a decline kind of a scenario. Is that what you're looking at, or you're indicating, similar 5-6% growth or single digit for remaining 8 months as well?
No, so overall for the year, we are saying roughly low single digits. Right. So that is what we are saying right now.
Okay. Understood. Okay. And the second question pertains to the tractor market share aspirations, which we had talked sometime back. Obviously, many things have changed, including COVID and other factors. Now, are we aspiring for the 15% market share over the next 2-3 years, or that will get pushed back further?
No, so what we had told in our Vision 2022 document was that we will achieve roughly 14-15% by year 22. Of course, as you know that we were continuously growing for 3-4 years. So we were like roughly around 10%, and then we were very, very close to 12% in 2019. And then, of course, last year and a half was roughly kind of lot of other factors played out, like supply chain, the stocks, etc. Right, but now I think everything. Now I think the whole industry is back on track. So it's a even platform for everybody to play around. Right. Of course, I mean we don't know about the third wave. If that would cause again some disruptions in terms of supply chain or some markets getting closed or something. But other than that, I think it's a level playing field again. So I think we are like kind of looking forward to continue on that growth path now onwards again. So yeah, it will, I mean, another 2 or 3 years, we would like to definitely touch that 15% mark.
Okay. And secondly, you indicated our inventory is lower than the industry. Can you give indication of what is our inventory level and what would be it for industry?
Yeah, so for tractors, I can say, I mean, what we hear, of course, I mean, you guys probably would know better, but what we hear is that the tractor industry average dealer stocks level would be roughly in the range of 45 to 50 days. And at Escorts, we are still kind of less than 30 days right now, right? So we are quite well placed in terms of inventory, that with dealerships as relative to the industry.
Thanks. And lastly, what would be our capex guidance for this year for tractors and overall as such?
So this will be again close to 300-325 crores, you know, what we indicated earlier in the last call. So we maintain that guidance now. And most of it, like I said, almost 275-280 crores will be actually on the tractor side only. So the balance will be reasonably small, 30-40 crores.
Got it. Thanks. I'll fall back into it.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Vijay Sarthi.
Yeah, hi. Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir. Just two questions. One, how has been the product mix this quarter sequentially? Realization has gone up. So is there any change in the product mix or it's been same, number one? Second question is, should one look at the emission norms that is likely in FY24? Is that scheduled or is there a chance of that getting postponed because of COVID or anything? Any color on that will help. Thank you.
Yeah, this is Shenu. So I think Pratik can give you some detailed data on the product mix. I'll answer the emission norms question. So you know that emission norms, the BT4 norms were supposed to come on greater than 50 HP tractor from 1st of October this year. But now the government has issued a notification where they have postponed it by 6 months. So for above 50 HP, BT4 will be now applicable from 1st of April next year, 2022. Right, and I think the pretext behind the postponement was the situation that we were all going through in COVID and all that. Right, the stage 5 norms for all tractors above 25 HP, which is slated to be on first with effective from 1st April 2024, is still on track, and we are not expecting any further postponements on that one now.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. We would like to remind participants that you may press star 1 to ask a question. The next question is from the line of Pramod Amte from Incred Capital. Please go ahead.
Hi. This is to Shenu. Sir, with regard to this emission norms, when you say 1st of April, this is for production cutoff or for the retail cutoff?
Yeah, so Pramod, 1st of April 2022 for above 50 HP BT4, that is the production cutoff date.
And considering that earlier the thought...
Sorry, go ahead.
Sorry. Earlier the government thought process was the, considering that it's a rural segment, production cutoff will happen earlier and then there will be a 6 month transition for dealers to do that. Does that stand intact even in the new norm?
Yeah, so there is, as far as taxes is concerned, there is no, there is no bar on like by what time you can sell, but we cannot produce after 1st of April 2022.
And in that context, do you see any pre-buy, and what is the expected price hike in those segments in the context of new emission? And do you see any pre-buying happening in next 1 year in the higher HP segment till the next of September?
Yeah, see, Pramod, as I explained, these norms are effective only on tractors greater than 50 horsepower. And 50 horsepower segment is still kind of under 10% industry contribution. Right, so there will be, of course, these tractors, this segment of tractors would be impacted, but it's not a very, very large share of the industry. Right, so this segment may see some pre-buying, but it's not going to make a significant difference to the whole industry.
Sure, sir. Thanks a lot.
You see my point?
Yes, sir, I got it. Thanks.
Yeah. Okay.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Mitul Shah from Reliance Security. Please go ahead.
Thank you for taking my question, sir. Sir, I have a question on tractor growth in terms of regional disparity. As we highlighted in our PPT, north growth was much lower compared to south and west, north and central, around 23% growth compared to 60% plus in south and west. Similar trend we have also seen in July, where industry growth being 3%, north declined by 5% roughly, south also declining, south growing. So how do you see this regional growth in coming months and full year FY22? Because we are more inclined towards north, or north contribution is quite high for exports. So how do you see its impact on market share?
Yeah, Mitul, thank you for asking that question. Now, you are right, Mitul, that since we are we have a very skewed share of market traditionally in the country, with some five or six states where we enjoy market share in the range of 13 to even 19%. And in some states, we are like, even now, we are like 5, 6%. And in some other states, we are still hovering around 8, 10. Right? So there is a significant difference in our market share from state to state. Now, and that is why if the industry grows much higher in, for example, states like South or West, where we have lower market share, you know, it just mathematically affects our overall market share very badly. So, for example, even in Q1, you know, if the market growth would have been equal in all these types of markets, then our market share growth would have been substantial, right? But because of this phenomena, we do suffer as far as our all India market share is concerned. Right now, coming to your question of the disparity, it is little bit unusual. Of course, in the long term, we know that West and South will grow slightly more than North and Center and East, right? But this time in quarter one, it has been quite unusual. So for example, in our strong markets, or the six states of Punjab, Haryana, MP, UP, Bihar and Rajasthan, the market has grown 23-24%. In Q1, while the markets in our weak markets or the four states of South has grown 64-65%, right, which is a huge disparity. Now, we know the reason why it has happened, because like most of the southern states or large parts of southern states, or even in West, lot of parts other than Marathwada, right, maybe, you know, they are rain fed and they are rain dependent. And therefore, whenever there is a good monsoon, we see this kind of phenomena that happens, that West and South, parts of West and South, they grow phenomenally well, right? So I think this will continue for maybe another two to three months before North also starts picking up back, because North is also receiving good rainfall now. And some of the markets in the North remain even subdued even last year, right? I mean, they did not show much growth. So this is the right time for even North and Center and East to bounce back. But I mean, already like we saw July as compared to Q1. So July, the growth was not that disproportionate as it was in Q1, right? So it's already kind of tapering back to normal, but probably another 2-3 months, we will have that disadvantage.
My second question is on industry growth. As we are highlighting low single digit or maybe around 5%, But as we all know, that inventory in a system is very high, probably at around close to 120,000 plus right now, compared to usual 70,000-80,000 for any August, which is a record high. So even if you adjust this inventory thing, and roughly which is around 5% of the annual number, so if you are assuming around 10% plus kind of a retail growth, then only 4-5% wholesale growth is possible. So do you see this situation like that, or inventory will still remain high at this level of 120 plus throughout?
Yeah, Mithul, I mean, of course, you have a better idea on inventory of at the industry level. See, I mean, there are two things. You know, one, the industry, the way industry has increased over last 2-3 years, right? I mean, there would be some increase in the inventory levels also at the industry level. You know, a lot of new dealers are getting created because of the spike in the industry in last 2-3 years. Everybody is pretty much doing that to enhance, to ensure that coverage of all the customers, right? So some of that, some of this inventory increase will get absorbed because of that new dealers that most of the companies are appointing. In our case, of course, you know that we are very aggressive on appointment of new dealers, and we have already reached 1,100 plus. 3-4 years ago, we were like close to 700, 750. Right, so a lot of inventory gets absorbed in that sense. And of course, there would be some correction also. Yeah, but correction may not be to the tune of 5%, I don't think. You know, 5% of the total industry. I think correction would be much lesser than that.
Yeah, thank you, sir. Lastly, on construction equipment, considering this cost inflation, what is the price hike taken and any shift in the break-even point from earlier guided number of 700 units?
Yeah, so as Bharat explained on inflation, specifically on tractors, the inflation is in the range of, let us say, 7-8% so far. And we have already taken three price increases. The last one was in July. And we have already passed on all inflation that we have experienced in absolute terms so far. Right, so that already has been passed on to the market. But now in quarter two, we are again expecting some inflation to come in, maybe roughly around 2% of the selling price, right? And that inflation we will pass on at the right time, sometime in quarter three.
Sir, I am asking on construction equipment cost inflation, pricing, and break-even point.
All right, okay. I'm sorry about that. Yeah, Ajay.
Sure. Can you hear me? Hello.
Yes, sir. My question is construction equipment side, what is price hike considering cost inflation and any change in break-even point compared to earlier indication?
We have passed on, generally pass on all the price increase to the market as a standard practice, because construction equipment does not have that kind of leverage available on the price. So BS4 plus the inflation price increase has been passed on 1:1, you know, 100% onto the market. Acceptance level is improving. We have, like, you know, if I talk about this month, probably we have recovered most of the inflation from the market. And, you know, as regard the break-even point, you know, we are running at a lower break-even point, 230, 235, I think Bharat would be able to explain you better. Break-even points are coming down because we are optimizing our cost. You know, year on year, we are optimizing our cost. There is a cost compression project that is running in the plant, and that's the reason why, you know, even with drop in volumes, we are able to maintain some amount of EBITDA.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. We would like to remind participants that you may press star 1 to ask a question. The next question is from the line of Saksham Kaushal from Philip Capital. Please go ahead.
Hi there. Thanks for the opportunity. Two questions. Further on the commodity side, you know, we gathered that the steel companies have again asked for a significant increase retrospectively, I think from 1st of July. And given that per tractor gross usage of steel is roughly 1700 kilos, and this time around, the increase is roughly, I think, the ask is 8-9 rupees per kg. And given the previous increases, as you've told, of 40 to 42,000. Do you think that we can pass this on without impacting demand? How would the demand play out if we pass this on? That's the first question, sir.
Yeah, so definitely, we are experiencing problems in the market because of frequent price hikes. Everybody is, right? So far it has not really affected the demand, but it has, the cycle itself is getting a little bit prolonged, the selling cycle, right? Because it's taking more time to really convert the customers and have them to a buying point. Right, so that is one phenomena we are seeing. We hope it will settle sometime soon. And the other thing is also, it is putting pressure on our margins. It is also putting some pressure on the dealer margins, because while we as manufacturers can raise the price, sometimes it is difficult for the dealers to immediately pass it on to the customers. We are going through some tough times from that perspective, from the inflation perspective. But we hope that probably this is the last quarter of such a high inflation. So things should settle down sometime soon.
So do you think that, if this price hike continues, you'd see a downsizing in the HP size mix? Because we gather the first quarter as well, the 2030 HP mix was a tad higher than what it was usually. And last year also, our mix for the 45 HP and above was around 61%. So you think any adverse impact because of the significant increases that we've had?
No, I don't think it will have a bearing on the HP wise segmentation. We know that tractors are being used more and more in income generating areas, right? And therefore, I think it will not have such a high bearing on the HP itself because of the price issue. But last year was extraordinarily high. Extraordinary swing happened from 30 to 40 to 42 50, right? And that may kind of neutralize a little bit this year, and we know the reasons for that. Why last year we had a high HP shift. So that may neutralize a bit, as we had already indicated earlier.
Thanks, sir. And sir, I think you indicated that the industry inventory is roughly around 45 to 50 days and ours is less than 30 days. Is that right?
Yeah, that is on industry, that is our guesstimate. Yeah.
So ours is less than 30 days, so it gives us a lot of scope to pump in for the festive season, because before festive, we would like to stock up, I guess.
Yeah, everybody would stock up more. It depends on, which players are at what level. We don't know that information very exactly. Yeah, but it gives us a little bit better scope.
Okay, sure, sir. Thanks.
Not necessarily that we will increase our inventory, continuously. We may increase it temporarily prior to the season, but then we would like to bring it back to the current levels.
I was asking near term only, if we are so well placed, so that gives us scope for the fest, everything's cramped up in October, so numbers for August and September should look good. So I was just asking from that point of view. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, please limit your questions to 2 per participant. Should you have a follow-up question, would request you to rejoin the queue. The next question is from the line of Aditya Makaria from HDFC. Go ahead.
Yes, sir. I just had 2 questions. Wanted your sense. Do you feel the penetration of tractors in a state like UP would be higher than perhaps what we see in the southern and western states? Would UP and Bihar be at par with the national average when it comes to tractor penetration?
Yeah, so we know that South and West has lower penetration than the more matured markets in the North. That is true.
Right.
So the Northern markets have the higher penetration. But Punjab and Haryana lead the pack in terms of penetration. And UP and Bihar is not at the level of Punjab and Haryana, of course. But South and West is further down.
Right. So, sir, I was just trying to understand, despite having a lot more fragmented land, you know, why would a state like UP and Bihar, because they both typically have smaller land holdings, you know, why would their penetration levels be higher than what we see as compared to the ones in the south? Is it due to better irrigation, or is it better, you know, government credit or subsidy, or, you know, just any color if you could throw on this?
Yeah, I think the reason is historical, because the agri revolution started much earlier in Punjab and Haryana, and then it trickled down to UP and Bihar and MP, and finally it got into south, right? So I think that is just the reason. It is just the timing. I mean eventually I think every state is going to, or every region is going to be at the same level as Punjab and Haryana are right now.
Okay, fair point. Got it, sir. Thank you.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Mihir Zaveri from Avendus. Please go ahead.
Yeah, thank you for the opportunity. Just one question on the operating leverage part. So when you said that the commodity pressure is around 200 bps, and given the guidance where we are in terms of the decline, we expect that there could be a decline in terms of numbers for the rest of months. How does operating leverage will play a part in terms of, and hence my question is that, how do you look at margins from the current trajectory of 14%? So do you think that, do you envisage that probably margins will now is likely to fall from these levels, and what would be your guidance on the same for the rest of the year? That's my only question. Thanks.
Sorry to interrupt, Mr. Zaveri. So there's a disturbance coming from your line. Request you to mute your line while the management answers your question.
Yeah, sure.
I'm sorry, I couldn't hear you that well. Can you repeat?
Sorry, sir. My question is...
I'll respond to that.
Okay. Sure, sir.
I mean, so as we mentioned, so like in June quarter, we're running a lag of about 3% in margin, you know, so which got postponed in July. And next, we're seeing this quarter, current quarter, we're again looking at 2% sort of inflation, which may set in, you know, which will be again, probably will have a lag. So essentially, you're looking at a improvement happening, but from a 3% lag last quarter, which got postponed this quarter, you're reducing it to 2%. So inflation intensity is not as high as it was earlier in the last quarter. So definitely that will actually help in improving margin further from where we were in the last quarter. And we see that trajectory. So if the inflation stabilizes going forward, so that definitely should help in the margin improvement further.
Madan sir, my question is that in case of a decline in terms of numbers, which we envisage, given that we have a low single digit number, how do we see that the margins will improve from the current 14% levels? Is what I wanted to understand.
No, so the overall, we are still looking at this current year, which will show mid-single digit growth. So we don't see they will have a negative impact to the operating leverage on a full year basis. So really, if your inflation is passed on, even though it happens with a lag, so end of the year, you'll still probably end the year, you know, with the fully recovered cost, with the increase which has happened. So really we don't see. So I think the margin overall should actually see an improvement from the level what you see in the first quarter, in the balance of year.
Okay. Thanks.
Thank you.
And just to clarify, you know, I mean, just to clarify that, you know, if we are saying like 5-6% industry growth the year, and last year was 900, so let us say 950, 960, somewhere in that range. Depending on that 5-6% thing, right? And if you look just at April, July, the industry has increased from roughly 230 to 294, right? So 65,000 odd gain against the whole year gain of like 50 to 60, right? So it's not like a deep decline or a significant decline in the rest of the 8 months, right? It's just like a few thousand tractors.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Maithili from Balakrishnan from Alchemy Capital. Please go ahead.
Hi. Just two quick questions. One, I wanted to get a sense from you of, you know, in terms of the exports, you know, clearly we have seen a very, very strong number there. So just wanted to get a sense from you, is this the Kubota JV sort of picking up, or is there your own exports to Kubota, and how exactly are you seeing that? And my second question was on the cash, because we have like a ton of cash right now on our balance sheet. So just curious as to, is there any indication of what exactly are we looking for given the cash?
Yeah, so on the export side, although we have started now with Kubota and the volumes, we are ramping up on a monthly basis. But still, the contribution of Kubota network to our exports is still very, very small, right? So whatever, most of the growth that we have achieved or the numbers you are seeing for Q1 is largely through our own network. Of course, in future, as we are progressing more and more with Kubota, their number will also grow and their contribution to our overall exports will also grow. But right now, it is not a significant or a very huge contribution. So most of the growth is through our channel only.
On the cash flow?
Because so I think on the cash front, obviously the company has some aspiration. Hello, can you hear me?
Yeah, sure. Yes, we can.
Yeah, so I said on the cash front, definitely company has some aspiration of growth, and we are also looking at some inorganic options for the business. Like you said, the railway was one of the interested business where we are keen to grow. And there are also other opportunities which we are evaluating, and they keep on coming. So definitely we'll strike at the right time, which is the right valuation, which also serves our purpose and helps the business grow and also gives a better returns to the shareholders. So as of now, it's a wait and watch. So, but if something comes up, definitely, which is of interest to us, we'd like to really utilize that money for the growth of the business in future.
Got it. And just if I can squeeze one in, any impact of the semiconductor shortage on our business?
No impact at all on our business because of that. We use we barely use any electronics in our practice right now.
Thanks a lot. That's all from my side.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Utkarsh from Point 72. Please go ahead.
Hey, thanks for the opportunity. Sir, I had two questions. Firstly, just on your guidance on the mid-single 5 to 6% industry growth. So what about Escorts? Given that we had a lower base in terms of the market share last year, and this year, like you had previously guided, that some of that market share losses would come back, and also you're sitting on lower inventory versus the market. So are you optimistic about beating the industry growth this year?
Yeah, we are very optimistic. I think we'll continue to beat industry growth this year and also going forward. We have been telling you our story, our plans about how we are planning to do that. And I think we are on track as far as our plans of growth are concerned. And broadly speaking, these are in two areas. As you are aware that we have a very poor coverage traditionally in the southern and the western markets, and that we are increasing now year on year. And also we are covering most of our white spaces now in the product portfolio. So both the things are on track, and we will see those results coming in future.
Got it. Well understood. And so just to clarify on your earlier comment on raw material inflation and pricing, so there is basically, if I summarize it, there is 2% raw material inflation next quarter, but you've taken 3% pricing, and this is just quarter on quarter that I'm seeing. So it's slightly better on margins for the next quarter, leaving aside the operating leverage aspect. Is that a fair understanding? And if so, by which quarter do you think that you can cover all of it? You mentioned that there might be another one coming in the third quarter. So if there is no inflation, should we assume that by third quarter, you're back to your level seen last year in terms of the COVID savings as well that you had?
So, of course, your understanding is correct. So, definitely, that's what we meant. So, if your lag is reducing, with the reducing intensity of impressions, definitely that will help in improving the margin. But obviously, 2% right now for the next quarter is a guess, fair estimate as of now. As you know, the steel companies are taking the price changes from retrospective date, and that settlement takes some time. It happens with some lag. Like, you know, they have settled the prices for the March quarter now. With the CM body, so with the steel company. So the April price impact is still pending, though we are fully provided for in the books of account, but still you don't know at what level it will get settled. And then again for the July quarter, what will happen there. So as of now, our fair estimate is about 2%. And if it remains at that level, then definitely it will see the margin improvement happening. Now, whether it will get fully passed on in Q3 or not, I think they will have to watch the industry and other players how they respond, because volume is equally important, you know, for the industry. So let's see. I think we wait and watch. But the idea is, so far the industry has been passing it on, and we expect, I think, the same momentum continues in future too. And if there's no further inflation in Q3, then probably by Q3 you will be leveled fully.
Understood, sir. So just to follow up there, so the second part of my question was also in terms of your COVID savings during last year, like any permanent savings on the OPEX side that you've done, and would that be 100, 200 tips? If you could quantify that, please.
I mean, it's difficult to say whether it'll be a permanent saving. Because like it seen in the Q3 and Q4 last year also, most of the cost piece started coming back. You know, the major costs on travel, promotion, there's a crack. You were back when the market returned back to normalcy. So in this quarter also, there have been some saving, you know, which has come up because the month of April, May, we saw some lockdown happening. So those savings were there, but whether they'll call it permanent, I think it's difficult to say that. I won't say they'll be real permanent. I think at the moment you go back to the normal situation, the cost does start going up again.
Got it, sir. Thank you. That's all for me.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Nishit Jalan from Access Capital. Please go ahead.
Hi, sir. Thank you for the opportunity. So my question is on ASPs in the tractor segment. If I look at, we have taken a good bit of a price increase, mix is better on the domestic side, as well as the export mix has gone up. Still, ASPs in the segment has increased by only 3.6% on a YY basis. What are we missing here that the ASPs are still not increasing to that extent?
To respond, I don't have visibility to this.
So one obviously is the mix. So was if the export mix, the realizations are not high, and when the export, the realization is slightly lower. And also again, the depends on what mix you're actually exporting. You know, because we're actually doing most of the small tractors, compact tractors there, you know, where the mix is slightly lower. But overall, yes, and if you look at the overall realizations, so they have gone up compared to last year. So last year, our segment 40 HP and above, the mix was better. So this quarter, we've seen a dip of actually about 1% or 1.5% in terms of the overall sale, which was 61% plus in more than 40 HP segment. This time is, I think, down to about 60%. So about 1% dip is there, but it's not significant dip, but definitely it'll have some impact on the ISR also. And secondly, on the non-tractor sale, which does happen, you know, so in terms of the overall constitution, which used to be 8 to 10%. So that's another factor, I believe, which can have some impact on the ASR.
Sure, sir. So just one follow-up. Typically, what is the non-tractor sales or the farm implement sales as a percentage of revenues in the overall tractor segment? And is it fair to assume that segment would be growing at a faster pace given the kind of higher penetration we are seeing in that segment?
So when I say non-tractor, it's not just mean implement sale, it can be spare parts, etc. So, you know, the engines and spare parts which get sold, you know, which is not strictly tractor. So normally this ranges from 8 to 10%, depending on quarter to quarter. So I think this time also it's about 9.5% in the overall segment sale.
Okay, so basically 8 to 10% is the non-tractor sale, which includes spares and farm implements and everything else.
That's right.
Okay, thank you so much.
Participants, to ask a question, you may press star and one now. The next question is from the line of Samir Deshpande from Fair Deal Investments. Please go ahead.
Good afternoon, everyone. So I would like to know about the railway equipment business. I think Mr. Madan mentioned that we will go in, grow in about low single digits, and would like to hope to maintain the margins at the same level as last year. The current order book seems to be a bit lower at around 300 crores because of the problems faced by the railways. So going forward, if there is no COVID wave or the third wave is not that severe, then do we hope the business in the second half or in the balance 9 months, it will grow well, or we will be just maintaining the margins and the turnover also at the same level as last year?
So, Samir, we actually had mentioned that the growth will be lower double digit. So, it's not lower single digit, first of all. So, from the last year's base, definitely it'll be good growth. You know, even a double digit means it can actually go up to 13-14% level from the last year's level. And if we maintain the last year's margin level also, I think it'll be still better, much better than last year, what we've seen in the numbers. So, in terms of the order book, yes, it's low because the issues with railway, so the production, it has been cut down by them and the tendering was actually not happening. But now we've seen some pickup has started happening on the railway front. Even though they're not running the trains at a pre-COVID level, they're still running at 65-70% level, you know, the normal situation. I think as the transportation picks up, as they start running to the normal level, the demand will also increase for the new parts and also for the spare parts for maintenance, you know, which is actually slowed down. So we expect the order book actually will start picking up now from maybe Q3 onwards, and by end of the year we should be back to the normal level. So right now what we're trying to do is to speed up the execution pace at railway for the existing order book, so that we are able to maintain the growth which we have indicated here.
Okay, good. And secondly, we have really done very well in this quarter, despite the raw material price increase, and we have been successful in passing on and without affecting the demand, because the competition in the industry is quite high. So congratulations to you people for doing really well in on the marketing as well as all other fronts and the cost optimization. But actually, I wanted to know, are we targeting any products in the farm allied machinery segment, which that is the farm implements, etc., which can be bundled with the tractors and which will help the farmers increasing their productivity and that is beat the competition in some way in this way? Are we doing anything on that front?
Yes. So as we have been saying that farm implements and attachments is going to be one of our focus area going forward. So we are in the process of you know, putting those plans together, and we have already launched a few implements in the market. Of course, very nascent stages. Yeah, but we have been launching some of those implements. But we are preparing also our plans in the long term, how to penetrate this part of the market. But yes, you are right. I mean, this is one of the strategic focus areas for us for expansion.
Because to my knowledge, I have heard from some of the large companies in the sector that the size of the farm allied machinery and implements business is a few times of the tractor industry. So is it true?
No. It is not few times, at least in India. You know, I mean, when you look at markets overseas, like more mature developed markets in Europe or USA, of course, the implement size, implement attachment industry is quite huge. But in India, it is not the case. I mean, in India, it is still kind of in the developing stage. You know, this whole industry was in the unorganized sector previously, right? But now a lot of attention is coming on this industry, and a lot of organized players are also entering. So while it is not a few times, it is like I mean, much less than the tractor industry in terms of value. But yes, it is going to grow quite rapidly in future.
With the GST and all other implementations, as the unorganized market is shrinking everywhere. So whenever, so I think the organized market and companies in the sector like us can see a big shift from the unorganized market. And I think when the tractor penetration sometimes at some point of time will face some hurdles, I think this segment will help us go, going forward.
You are absolutely right. You are absolutely right. This is something very, very important for the industry, not just for us. And we are also like putting a lot of focus on this part.
Okay. Thank you and all the best to you. And there was one more question. It was regarding the surplus on the balance sheet. We really have a healthy balance sheet in the 75th year, and we have around 3,000 odd crores surplus. There will be some capex which is still not very large and staggered manner. So I think it is a challenge to deploy that money in the money market instruments here and there. We hardly get any 4-5% here and there. But with this, our other income for this quarter was around 50 crores. So what will be the expected run rate of other income going forward for the balance year?
So Samirji, it will be in this range only. It will be somewhere around 40-45 crores each quarter at the current level of cash equity which we have on the balance sheet. And if it goes further, then definitely you'll see the further upside there.
Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, please limit your questions to one per participant. Should you have a follow-up question, would request you to rejoin the queue. The next question is from the line of Saksham Kaushal from PhillipCapital. Please go ahead.
Hi, sir. Thanks for taking my question again. Just wanted to check on the discounting levels and the dealer support that is there, and given how the industry inventory, as we talked about. So could you just comment on how it is for us and the competition as well, especially the discounting and dealer support?
Actually, we haven't seen any changes per se in discounting, even even at the industry level, and definitely for us, right? Normally, I mean, in tractor industry, that is not a very huge play, right? So discounts are like very, I mean, normal and static.
Okay, sure, sir. Thanks.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Jinesh Gandhi from Motilal Oswal Financial Services. Please go ahead.
Hi, sir. My question pertains to the railway business. We have seen a near doubling of contribution from the new orders, new products as such. So do we expect these levels to sustain? And if yes, what does it imply for sustainable margins for railways? Hello?
Yeah, Jinesh, so as we have seen, the proportion of the new product development has been increasing. So that's something, a trend which will continue, I think, in future too. And as we had mentioned earlier also, I think in the earlier call, so I think there's a maturity cycle to any new product which gets introduced. So over the period of few years, you know, then your cost starts coming down. And in these particular products, since we are also importing a lot, and there's an effort to do the localization there, you know, on those parts. So the moment you go through the localization process, the margin actually will improve further. So there are a number of products which are in the pipeline. So there'll always be some cycle which will be there. So idea is to have those margin which will remain in the range of 17 to 20% sort of range, you know, for this business end of the day. So I think we will probably be maintaining those sort of levels, you know, in going forward to on this business.
Okay, got it. And lastly, with respect to our farm machinery sales ex of tractors, what it would be currently, what percentage of our revenues or absolute sales would be coming from farm machinery?
So right now it's not much, actually, like you mentioned. So it's only recently started entering into this area now. So there's a few products which have been introduced only last quarter. So, but this is one significant area where the focus of the company is, and that should continue to do well. So I think in the times to come, maybe when we come back to you with our next plan for the midterm business plan, you know, by the end of this year, hopefully you will get more clarity what sort of revenue we're expecting from this and how the lines will get built up.
Got it. Thanks and all the best.
Thank you. Thank
you.
The next question is from the line of Mitul Shah from Reliance Securities. Please go ahead.
Thank you for giving opportunity again, sir. So as we guided for single digit growth on a full year basis, so I want to understand some near term visibility in terms of next few months, say August, September. Even if I am assuming 8-10% kind of a growth over pre-COVID peak level of tractor industry volume for August, September, still it is translating into kind of a 15-20% decline on a YOY basis. So can you throw some more light on next few months?
Yeah, Mitul. Hello.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, Mitul. Overall, like we are still sticking to that guidance of 5-6%, and the tractor industry in absolute numbers has been up 60-65,000 units April, July. Right, and if we say 5-6%, the industry would be roughly around, like, let us say 950-960 for the whole year, which is about 50-60,000 more than last year. Right, so first of all, I mean, we are not saying that there will be a kind of a significant decline in the rest of the period. It will be roughly kind of similar, you know. I mean, if we just consider August March period, it would be roughly similar, maybe 5-10,000 tractors less. On a base of roughly 600,000 tractors. Yeah, now, last year was a very, very different year because there were a lot of challenges, and these challenges were different with different companies, and at different times they were different because of the supply chain issues. Because most of the supply chain issues that we faced as an industry was in the period July to October. And then after November or mid-November, the supply chain started getting stabilized. Now, of course, there is a general sense in the industry that there was a pent-up demand in this period from the first quarter. But also, there were some supply side shortages, right? And therefore, I would kind of like to think that while the rest for the 8 months, we are saying that the more or less the industry would be at same levels as last year, I think there is still some growth that we will see in the next 3-4 months, and probably some decline then going forward, right? But on absolute basis, number basis, the 8 months would be more or less same as last year.
Thank you, sir. Lastly, on the sir competition from small players, new players, like recently we have seen this Kubota, Preet Tractor, Captain, all those players put together, market share has improved sizably over last one and a half year. Any view on that?
Yeah, I think Mitul, the most important player out of these players that you named, I think, is Kubota. Right, because Kubota has come in at a premium side and is trying to establish its network and also its products in the Indian market. So we think that Kubota has a lot of upside, in the market in terms of market share, because they are like 3 or 4 product company, and they are only present in a few states right now. So they have a lot of upside. Of course, we are watching every other player, small or big, in the market. Yeah, but as I said, the prospects of Kubota for growth are the highest right now, in our view.
Thank you. As there are no further questions, I would now like to hand the conference over to Mr. Madan for closing comments.
Thank you, ladies and gentlemen, for being present on this call. For any feedback and or queries, please feel free to write in to us at investorrelation@escorts.co.in. Thank you very much and have a good evening. Please take care and stay safe and healthy.
Thank you. On behalf of Anand Rathi Share and Stock Brokers, that concludes this conference. Thank you for joining us, and you may now disconnect your lines.